Well, good evening and welcome to tonight's J.J. Quinn, the Society of Jesus Memorial Lecture for 2010. Before I begin, let me just note that it is rather warm in here, so if you feel appropriately overdressed, you may now appropriately get rid of some of that. Take off those jackets and furs and whatever else one wears to a Shakespeare lecture, and be prepared to sit in warmth, but don't punish yourself. This is a nice night each year because it honors a respected and beloved member of the English department, J.J. Quinn. There are now regrettably fewer and fewer people on campus that remember him, but he was a force. He was a presence in the English, not just in the English department, but in the entire university. His interest in Catholic literature, particularly, at least for me, memorable is his interest in Flannery O'Connor. It has his presence at the time and his memory, of course, is a central factor in our identity as a Jesuit institution. He contributed greatly to that. It didn't hurt that he was rather laconic and sarcastic as well. But he really was a tremendous presence, and we enjoyed him, and we enjoy the opportunity to honor his memory tonight with tonight's lecture. Our lecturer tonight is Joan Ozark Homer, who is a professor of emeritus at Georgetown University, where she has taught for 35 years. She has, as your program notes, specialized in a number of different areas, some of which you will understand as ordinary, some of which strike me as sort of interesting. And she's already laughing because she's concerned about where I'm going with this. But her interests have ranged from Renaissance literature to fairy mythology to gender roles, moral philosophy, and what interests me in particular, although it's not tonight's subject, is performance phenomenology, which is something I'm sure the philosophy department would be here for if they only understood what it was. Many of you were not here for the dinner at which Father Pilars, the president of the university, introduced our speaker and mentioned that Joan changed his life. She was moved by that. And I must say, however, that virtually everyone at Georgetown changed Father Pilar's life. So one must be careful about how sincerely one takes those compliments. They were meant sincerely, but you want to be careful what you take home with you. Tonight's lecture, and I was asked to be brief, so I will conclude here before I get myself into any deeper trouble. Tonight's lecture is, and this also, oddly enough, is in your program, is Shakespeare and the Drama of Love. I take a great bit of pleasure and an honor in introducing to you a fabulous teacher. If there was anything I learned at dinner listening to her talk and actually at the cocktail hour that preceded it, also hearing her talk, is that you have ahead of you a witty, erudite, and really compelling teacher. So I present to you for tonight's lecture, Joan Ozark Homer. Joan?
Thank Thank you, Hal, for that very warm and generous introduction. And thank all of you for coming here tonight on this beautifully warm evening. I am truly delighted to be here, and I have not had the privilege of being on this campus since I drove up for the inauguration of your illustrious president. And he has said some very nice things about my teaching tonight, but what I would want you to know is that the truly stellar teacher in this room is Father Pilar's. To the best of my knowledge, no one in the history of Georgetown University has ever won the Edward B. Bunn Award for Teaching Excellence in just their third year of teaching, except for President Pilar's. So we all deeply miss him at Georgetown, and you, I know, realize how blessed you are to have him. For our time together today, I want to share with you some Renaissance ideas and ideals for love, primarily shaped by Christianity and especially St. Augustine. For Shakespeare, I will focus chiefly on romantic love in two well-known and frequently performed plays, Romeo and Juliet and The Merchant of Venice. They were written within 2 years of each other in the different genres of tragedy and comedy. My topic concerning Shakespeare and the drama of love is truly inexhaustible, but it catapulted into the limelight for the general public's awareness when the blockbuster film Shakespeare in Love won 7 Academy Awards, including Best Picture in 1999. Many of you will recall that film and how well it incorporated Shakespeare's stunning poetic language while using his tragedy Romeo and Juliet to create a fictitious and comedic love story for the playwright himself. Aside from this film's many merits, it features 2 misleading emphases concerning marriage and playwriting that are germane for introducing my topic. What about Shakespeare on marriage? What Juliet herself calls the honor of marriage graces the love of this play's young protagonist. Depending on how one wishes to read Romeo's line in the first balcony scene, "Oh, wilt thou leave me so unsatisfied?" one must acknowledge that the merely 13-year-old Juliet informs Romeo that if his love is honorable, his purpose must be marriage. But in the film, Lady Viola de Lesseps and Will Shakespeare love each other outside of marriage, as if the institution of marriage, arranged or otherwise, was more of a trap than an honor. And the film accordingly presents both lovers as unhappy in their marriages. Herein, the film reflects more the values of the post-1960s sexual revolution, appropriate for a modern rather than an Elizabethan audience. Whatever may have been Shakespeare's actual experiences in love, other than his marriage to Anne Hathaway, we must admit that we do not know what they are. Of course, Shakespeare could have written Romeo and Juliet based on his personal experience of a star-crossed love affair, but we simply do not know anything factual about such an affair. Something I might deduce, however, is that at the time he wrote this love tragedy in 1596, he was 32 years old, but his daughter Susanna was 13. The same age that Shakespeare chose for his Juliet, making her younger than any Juliet in the earlier versions of this love story. Did traits of his own daughter enhance his brilliant characterization of Juliet? Although Stephen Greenblatt, in his bestseller, Will in the World, agrees with the film's depiction of Shakespeare as unhappy in his marriage, one might counter that if actions speak louder than words, it may be telling that Shakespeare returns to Anne in Stratford after he retires in 1611, whereas he could have resided in London, having bought the gatehouse at Blackfriars in 1613, or he could have abandoned his wife as his fellow playwright, Robert Greene, did his. Speculation about Shakespeare's life, which probably influenced his plays, will continue to thrive in the absence of further historical evidence. What about Shakespeare and playwriting? The film emphasizes that great art comes out of actual experience and ignores book learning. However, we do know much more about Shakespeare's habits of composition than we do the affairs of his heart. Contrary to the film's presentation of Shakespeare as trying to write ex nihilo, that is, as if out of nothing with a blank sheet of paper in front of him, we know that he consulted other texts for his stories. There are only several plays for which scholars have not yet found the main literary sources Shakespeare used. Was this plagiarism? By our modern standards, yes, but not if judged by the compositional habits of his era. Shakespeare and his contemporaries freely borrowed from the works of others to create their own. In the rhetorical tradition of imitatio, or imitation, they closely imitated or emulated previous authors, but did not slavishly copy them. We might describe Shakespeare's dramatic artistry as figurative alchemy. His genius as a writer is essentially transformative. He takes the base lead of his literary sources and transmutes them to the pure gold of his dramas, which, like gold, have withstood a figurative test of fire, namely the test of over 400 years of time. On the other hand, some of Shakespeare's sources were not base lead, but the gold and silver achievements of other authors, classical like Ovid, or contemporary like Marlowe. But the point I wish to make here is that the film, Shakespeare in Love, misleads us about how Shakespeare typically composed his plays, when it disregards the context of written materials from which he borrowed, like Prospero, whom Shakespeare describes as having loved his books. He was a prodigious reader. Scholars frequently marvel at how much and how widely he read and how fertile and far-reaching was the operation of his memory for his dramatic use of these readings. And Shakespeare's typical pattern for composing plays was combinative, using not just one, but usually several resources. In my work on Shakespeare's imagery, I find his poetic imagination seems to function in terms of what I like to call literary fission and fusion for newly recombined effects. That is, he often fuses or unifies into a more complex whole that which he finds separate or disjoined in his sources. His imagery, therefore, forges more connections. In this respect, he excels in representing the ancient critical theory of art as imitation and the 16th century notion that the poetic feigning of images is a process of severing and joining things real to form things imagined. For example, in Romeo and Juliet, he borrows from Thomas Nash the image of a catfight for a quarrel among men, but he adds to it the tool for fighting, the rapier or the English gentleman's new weapon, so that now one can use just the tip of a sword to scratch a man to death, as Mercutio laments Tybalt, the Prince of Cats, has done to him. Shakespeare's contemporary, Francis Marries, praised his poetry for portraying the perplexities of love. And I think Shakespeare arguably wears the crown for representing the varieties and vagaries of love on the English stage. Neither of the two dramatic rivals, Christopher Marlowe and Ben Jonson, with whom Shakespeare is most frequently compared, makes love a central focus in most of their plays. But love, in its many forms, pervades virtually all of Shakespeare's plays in major ways. I cannot possibly do justice to the many ideas about love pertinent for Shakespeare's era, but before looking specifically at two plays, I will share with you a few ideas I've come to see as essential for this topic, in an attempt to recover knowledge that helps us appreciate more fully the plays as he wrote them for his audience, and consequently how they do or do not relate to us today. Something as basic as the idea of love and its significance for dominant Elizabethan views of the universe and the individual might be a starting point. Love, like the idea of order, particularly hierarchical order, is one of the era's most important concepts. For Elizabethans, love is nothing less than God's principle of harmony in the universe, as well as the ideal basis of human community. Although the new ideas of Copernicus and his theory of a heliocentric universe were published in 1543, The dominant view of the universe then was still the second century one of the Alexandrian astronomer Ptolemy, namely a geocentric cosmology with the heavenly bodies in concentric spheres revolving around the Earth at their center. How did Elizabethans think that the planets and stars moved? Instead of our modern laws of gravity, it was believed these spheres were set in motion by the hypothetical ninth sphere called the prima mobile, which simply means the first movable. The unmoving mover of the universe was God. Reasoning by analogical argument, it was deduced that just as the object of desire moves the desirer, so also the prima mobile moved out of love for its creator, God. Dante, for example, closes his Divine Comedy with a vision of God's love that moves the sun and all the other stars. Thus, for them, love literally did make the world go round, at least in theory. Celestial space was not believed to be a vast abyss of darkness, but rather flooded with light and the music made by the harmonious movement of the heavenly spheres. At the end of The Merchant of Venice, Lorenzo's speech to Jessica in the moonlight provides one of the most lyrical expressions of heaven's sweet harmony that also exists in immortal souls. Although we cannot hear it, while the body, this muddy vesture of decay, encloses us. Moreover, Elizabethans recognize the biblical definition that God is love. The law on which Christianity was supposed to be founded was the law of love, of God and neighbor. Hence, ideal Christianity in Reformation England was not supposed to be a religion of priggish self-righteousness, which it tends to become under the Puritans, but rather a faith that operates through love. This religious ideal had wide-ranging consequences. Take, for example, the problem of human morality. Human behavior was, at this time, analyzed primarily in terms of morality, not our modern propensity for psychological drives and situational ethics. Morality in the 16th century was founded on the principle that human behavior is ultimately a matter of love. If humans could be led to love properly, that is to love spiritual more than physical realities, they could live together in harmony. Thus, spiritual reality, not the physical reality enshrined by science, was ideally viewed as the ultimate reality. The issue of virtues and vices, that is good and bad habits, tended to be judged on the basis of moral philosophy. And I know you recall that philosophy simply means the love of wisdom, and not judged, as tends to be the case today, on the basis of secular psychology. Therefore, love, whether true or false, proper or improper, is an important theme because human life cannot flourish without love. Drama, as an art form, is essentially centered on human events and interaction. But part of what makes Shakespearean drama so intriguing is that the idea of conflict native to drama is rooted for the Renaissance in the human being's very nature, in the conflict between the individual's animal body and rational soul. Given the supposed order of God's hierarchical creation, only human beings joined in their hybrid nature, two orders of beings that are different in kind, not simply in degree. Man shared a physical body with animals and a rational soul with God, in whose image, as Genesis maintains, humans were created. What might be some influential definitions of love for Shakespeare's era? Perhaps madness is one of the oldest popularly shared definitions of romantic love, and Romeo utters an oxymoronic description of love as a madness most discreet. Even our language records an inexplicable sense of being out of control when we talk about falling in love. And by the way, today we have scientific research on the physiology of passion demonstrating that biochemical changes such as elevated levels of dopamine do occur in the brain when one falls madly in love. Deborah Sugar, in her book, Habits of Thought in the English Renaissance, tries to summarize the conceptualization of love in the Western world. She cites two well-known paradigms for love in Western Christianity based on Greek terms. One models love on sexual desire or eros. The other views love in terms of friendship or philia, which Aristotle held could exist only between equals, but which Thomas Aquinas later held could exist between unequals, such as man and God. Sugar also argues that an important and widespread redefinition of love modeled on parental affection occurs in the Renaissance, with the love of parents for children becoming the primary metaphor for divine love. And the quality of parental love is an issue in both of these plays. In her book, A Precious Thing, Love and Reason in Shakespeare's Plays, Barbara Parker supplements Sugar's view and rightly observes that any consideration of Renaissance love theory must begin with Augustine, since his distinction between right and wrong love underlies all subsequent notions of love. For him, all action, both good and evil, is rooted in love. How we use or direct this love, or the motion of the soul, determines our physical and spiritual health. Parker explains that Augustine asserted that the ethical quality of love derived from the object or direction as to which there were two possibilities, either upward toward God the Creator or downward toward temporal or created things. I have to pause for a second here to explain this iconographic Renaissance painting by Paolo Veronese. And the Italian title for it may be translated, The Virtue That Stops Vice. It's the most intriguing picture I could find for suggesting Augustine's idea about love's direction or object. Given the typical gender bias of this era, the man here is associated with the human's rational soul that looks upward to God, and the woman is associated with the human's animal nature that looks downward to the earth. Hence, within each human being, the rational soul was supposed to guide and govern properly one's physical nature, one's animal passions and fleshly appetites, hence the bridle and the whip. On Augustine's concept about the ethical quality of love rests the fundamental distinction between caritas, charity, and cupiditas, or cupidity. In his very influential book on Christian doctrine, Augustine defines charity as the motion of the soul toward God for his own sake and the enjoyment of oneself and others for God's sake. Cupidity is the motion of the soul toward enjoyment of anyone or anything for any purpose other than for God's sake. Thus, charity corresponds with human reason and cupidity with our sensual nature. The ultimate source and end of all human love is God. Given these ideas about marriage, what can we say about marriage, the only honorable goal of romantic love, as Juliet proclaimed? While the definition of marriage is a hot-button topic in today's society, the idea of marriage for the Middle Ages and the Renaissance possesses both literal and figurative meaning. The literal act of marriage signified the union of opposite sexes in the paradoxical mystery of two becoming one flesh in God's eyes, honoring both the body and the soul. Marriage was defined as the institution through which a man and a woman were united in a relationship of social and legal dependence for the purpose of founding and maintaining a family. In The Merchant of Venice, for example, the lovers in Belmont are thinking procreatively before they even take their marriage vows when they playfully wager which couple will have the first son. The patriarchal family, the sole locus for legitimate sex, was in turn the bedrock of moral and civil order for society. No wonder Prospero in The Tempest warns the lovers not to give dalliance too much the rein, because the fire in the blood caused by love can burn like straw their oath to remain chaste until their wedding. Basic ideas about marriage do not change suddenly and radically in the 16th century. Both Catholic and Protestant writers variously emphasize reasons for marriage as procreation, a refuge from the sin of lust, a source of comfort, companionship, and spiritual advantages, and as the expression of mutual love and fidelity. What does change is that beginning with the Reformation, marriage became an institution celebrated in the church, but ultimately controlled by the state. Protestants also repudiated the Catholic ideas of marriage as a sacrament and celibacy as a superior path to holiness. How about the figurative sense of marriage for this era? Like the chain of being metaphor, which was used to signify created hierarchy, marriage could also be used as a metaphor to signify any well-ordered hierarchy. What is a well-ordered hierarchy? One that is based on a proper love relationship, for example, as defined by Augustine. In medieval Renaissance discourse, the marriage metaphor has a venerable history, allegorically signifying a variety of social, political, and personal unions based on the spiritual model of Christ and the church. For example, as Christ is wedded to the church, so should the husband be married to the wife, the ruler to the nation, and the soul to the body. In light of the era's well-known reliance on arranged marriages that typically prioritized a family's social and economic advantages over the personal preferences of the bride and the groom, the description of ideal marital love found in the rite of matrimony should be kept in mind because it emphasizes the marriage metaphor of Christ and the church. This description is articulated prominently at the beginning and at the end of the rite, and I'm going to read one short passage from the 1559 version of the Book of Common Prayer, simply so that you can hear what Elizabethans heard. O God, who has consecrated the state of matrimony to such an excellent mystery that in it is signified and represented the spiritual marriage and unity betwixt Christ and his church. Look mercifully upon these thy servants, that both this man may love his wife according to thy word as Christ did love thy spouse, the church, who gave himself for it, loving and cherishing it, even as his own flesh. And also that this woman may be loving and amiable to her husband. O Lord, bless them both and grant them to inherit thy everlasting kingdom. In his amatory sonnet sequence, the great poet Edmund Spenser articulates this idea that human love should be modeled on the example of divine love. The concluding couplet of his Easter sonnet to his own bride-to-be urges, so let us love, dear love, like as we ought. Love is the lesson the Lord us taught. What I have just spent time trying to recover here is some sense of the ideal for human love in the Renaissance. Why? Because it is this ideal that we moderns are less familiar with, as my students constantly used to remind me. However, we are very familiar, as were the Elizabethans, with what Hamlet calls the heyday in the blood, and familiar with the Ovidian portrayal of sensual love and its fleshly delights that was also frequently presented in the Carpe Diem love literature of this era. Shakespeare's plays involve us, as they do as characters, in tough choices for or against love, involving real risks, and therein art mirrors nature. How do we, who are neither disembodied spirits nor dispirited bodies, draw the line between love and lust? I have no better definition of lust, should you need one, than the opening lines of Shakespeare's sonnet 129. The expense of spirit in a waste of shame is lust in action. All too often, we end up meriting Puck's observation to Oberon. Lord, what fools these mortals be. Loving wisely, not foolishly, in all aspects of life may be the most difficult challenge of all. Shakespeare's dramas continually explore and enact that challenge, but practice seldom keeps pace with theory, then or now. Bottom's old observation, and yet, to say truth, reason and love keep little company together nowadays, is probably just as true nowadays. But how we explain and evaluate that behavior has changed in many respects. The old expectation that reason and love should be compatible in ideal love has significantly eroded in the advent of modernity, with its celebration of raw passion and sexual license, so visibly apparent in print TV, MTV, and film. An eye-opening Renaissance perspective on what constitutes admirable human love is articulated by John Milton in his epic Paradise Lost. The angel Raphael instructs Adam how to love his wife Eve rightly, with a love that is rationally guided and not lustfully passionate. Raphael says, "In loving thou dost well, in passion not, wherein true love consists not. Love refines the thoughts and heart enlarges, hath his seat in reason and is judicious, is the scale by which to heavenly love thou mayest ascend, not sunk in carnal pleasure, for which cause among the beasts no mate for thee was found." Milton's advice is a good index to one crucial area of divergence, I think, between Shakespeare's time and ours. Could we ever find a Hallmark greeting card for Valentine's Day that would bear a Miltonic-like inscription that romantic or marital love should be judicious or grounded in reason? Today, we too value the importance of love, the need for love. But how do we and our culture tend to define it? As primarily passion? As sunk in carnal pleasure? But what about our all-too-human difficulty in using reason rightly to distinguish love from lust? Shakespeare was keenly aware of the limitations of human reason, even though Renaissance humanism praised the angelic faculty of man's reason and tended to emphasize its positive potential as the divine image in us that makes us able to become godlike in virtue. Reason needs to be used rightly in guiding the body. But can reason make mistakes? Yes, if it is used wrongly or functions wrongly. Since the fall of man, reason was believed to be darkened and the will weakened compared to our prelapsarian parents. Reason can err because it can be misinformed or misguided by the faculty of will and/or the passions. For example, Hamlet admonishes Gertrude for her lack of good judgment in marrying Claudius, concluding incisively that in this case, reason panders will. Reason typically errs by choosing false things that only appear to be good. Hence, in Milton's epic, Adam counsels Eve that they do not have to fear external harm. Rather, as Adam says, within them the danger lies, because they have the rational free choice to say yes or no to temptation. As the Elizabethan statesman Thomas Wilson explained, human choices that adhere to the will of God are essentially right. Choices that violate the will of God are essentially wrong. But how do we know for certain the will of God? After the Reformation, that problem was complicated with competing theologies, Catholicism versus Protestantism, as well as various sects within Protestantism. Nonetheless, for Elizabethans to realize their fullest human potential, they needed to model the spirit of their loving on God's divine example. Aye, there's the rub, as Hamlet might say. How and why might Shakespeare adapt some of these ideas about love for Romeo and Juliet? First of all, we need to recall Shakespeare's originality in writing this play. In Elizabethan drama, romance was a subject of comedy. But Shakespeare takes the traditionally comic subject of love, especially young love, and converts it to tragic notes. His play, then, is surprisingly the first extant romantic tragedy on the English stage. This first-time endeavor also turns out to be the most famous example of romantic tragedy over the subsequent 400 years. What does this play reveal about the power of love in light of its foil, hate? Why should we try to understand the phenomenon of love? Does love change you? Is romantic love a phenomenon of grand passion? Or can it be something more? In this tragedy, Shakespeare created two of the most charming and engaging young people ever to grace the stage. The play's heart-stopping lyricism enraptures us. For example, Juliet's spacious expression of her love to Romeo. My bounty is as boundless as the sea. My love is deep. The more I give to thee, the more I have, for both are infinite. Almost an anatomy of love poetry, the play presents different poetic conceptions of love, such as love as madness, love as war, love as religion, and love as sickness, hence our term lovesick. And these various conceptions of love have competing spokespersons as diverse as the philosophical friar, the bawdy Mercutio, the fleshly nurse, and the rarefied lovers. Romeo's role is described by Mercutio as specifically that of a lover. Given the play's various perspectives on love, his role is even somewhat paradoxical. Romeo is violent in the nature of his love, as the friar would not have him be. But Romeo is not violent in his physical relationship to Juliet, as the sexually macho stance of men like Samson and Mercutio would have him be, that is, thrusting women to the wall or being rough with love. Although the play's second chorus stresses the passionate power of Romeo and Juliet's extreme suite, it sounds strange to us moderns to hear the friar describe Romeo's love for Juliet as violent delights in his premarital warning to Romeo about the combustible danger of such intense love. These violent delights have violent ends, and in their triumph die like fire and powder, which as they kiss, consume. From a modern viewpoint, the friar seems less prudent and more prude. Quite contrary to the message of today's Hollywood, the friar counsels Romeo to avoid extremes. Therefore, love moderately, long love doth so. For Elizabethans, violence could characterize either love or hate, and the play explores both. Unlike our modern bias favoring the intensity of extremely passionate love as an indicator of true love, Elizabethans tended, at least in theory, to distrust violence and to see it as indicative of mutability. Their proverbial wisdom insisted that extremes do not hold, that nothing violent, including love, could be permanent. However, Shakespeare complicates this notion with a paradoxical twist. Romeo and Juliet physically die, but their intense love does not die. It proves constant. In his bestseller, Shakespeare, The Invention of the Human, Harold Bloom claims, Romeo and Juliet is unmatched in Shakespeare and in the world's literature as a vision of uncompromising mutual love that perishes of its own idealism and intensity. But the intense love itself does not perish. The lovers themselves do. The love is unquestionably intense, but is it always uncompromising? Let us reflect on one example in response to Bloom. Shakespeare changes his literary source for the love story, Arthur Brooke's poem published in 1562, regarding the pivotal duel scene midpoint in the play, precisely in order to compromise Romeo's love for Juliet. It is a compromise that turns the play's opening comedy in the direction of tragedy. For example, in Brooke's poem, Romeo fights Tybalt in self-defense after having been struck twice and having tried to be a peacemaker on behalf of God and the Commonwealth. Shakespeare deletes these religious and political reasons. Instead, he personalizes the choice in terms of Romeo's love for Juliet. Romeo has to choose between the love of romance and the love of friendship, between his love for Juliet and his desire to revenge his dear friend Mercutio's death, as well as his own slandered reputation. He now decries his love for Juliet as an effeminate force. Oh, sweet Juliet, thy beauty hath made me effeminate, and in my temper softened valor steel. Romeo consequently compromises his love for Juliet when he embraces the macho ethic of Tybalt's revenge code, which fuels the feud as well as the warrior definition of manhood. And fire-eyed fury, be my conduct now! After killing Tybalt, Romeo bemoans that he is fortune's fool and flees the fatal scene. Is love strength or weak effeminacy? Must one violently revenge wrongs to be a man? Being so young and youth being an extenuating excuse, Romeo is arguably the least responsible of all Shakespearean tragic heroes. Yet Shakespeare also altered Brooke's poem in ways that complicate and heighten Romeo's role of tragic responsibility by confronting him with more difficult choices. Many approach this play as an apprentice piece, but that underestimates this tragedy's dramatic excellence. What often may be overlooked is Shakespeare's emphasis on moral philosophy and the rhetoric of paradox. The presentation of youthful romantic love within the context of hate's ancient grudge is far more complex than usually imagined. Why? Partly because Shakespeare develops the stature of his Romeo as a tragic protagonist against the philosophy of Friar Lawrence's definition of nature and human nature that is a paradox. It is a definition that depends on the idea of use, how to use nature, whether for life or for death. Friar Lawrence's long opening soliloquy as he gathers plants importantly addresses the correspondence between nature and human nature in relation to good and ill. And by the way, the entire soliloquy is cut in Franco Zeffirelli's beautiful 1968 film production, cut even though this long speech is Shakespeare's addition to his literary sources. Using the classical idea of earth as both nature's womb and tomb, Shakespeare analogizes nature and human nature in terms of their paradoxical intertwinings of good and ill. On the earth, there lives nothing so vile that it does not also have some special good, nor is anything so good that it can't stumble on abuse. Shakespeare concludes most powerfully with his own paradox, a vicious virtue and virtuous vice. Virtue itself turns vice being misapplied, and vice sometime by action dignified. One would expect to find the friar's sententious soliloquy placed somewhere near one of the deadly duels. Instead, it is dramatically contextualized for Romeo's affairs of the heart because he comes to tell the friar about his new love, Juliet. Shakespeare has Romeo enter just as the friar begins his emblematic conclusion. Romeo enters and remains on stage as a visual embodiment of the friar's meditation on the weak flower he holds in his hand. By the way, I chose your color purple. Scranton, all the way. Within the infant rind of this weak flower, poison hath residence and medicine power. For this being smelt, with that part cheers each part, being tasted, stays all senses with the heart. Two such opposed kings encamp them still, in man as well as herbs, grace and rude will. And where the worser is predominant, full soon the canker death eats up that plant. This is not simply the opposition of good versus evil entities. Shakespeare locates the potential for both good and ill within the same individual entity. Whether one is poisoned or healed depends on how one uses this flower that the friar is holding, whether one tastes it or smells it. Whether one dies or lives depends on how one uses one's own nature. Shall grace or rude, that is violent, will predominate? The blessing of Romeo and Juliet's faithful love shines all the brighter against the foil of Verona's benighted feud. But how should they use their love? At the end, Romeo's tragic drinking of the apothecary's poison in order to die and lie with Juliet contrasts with Juliet's earlier non-tragic drinking of the friar's potion to live and love. And this recalls Friar Lawrence's initial imagery of the flower's use for medicine or poison that is analogous to a person's use of either life-sustaining grace or death-determining rude will. As the play's opening chorus foretold, the patriarchs do finally join hands in reconciliation, just as their offspring earlier joined their hands in marriage. But at what tragic cost to Verona? Capulet and Montague's peace offerings of their children's statues, really golden sarcophagi on monumental tombs, are cold, barren substitutes for the now lost warm flesh and blood of their only offspring. The prevalent view in criticism and performance today is that the intensity of ideal romantic love is the principal significance of this play. But other critics question the extreme intensity and to what extent the love represents an ideal, especially for Elizabethans. Harold Bloom asserts, Romeo and Juliet is the most persuasive celebration of romantic love in Western literature. Is it only a celebration? Or is it also a questioning, even an exploration? Turning now to The Merchant of Venice, how and why does Shakespeare attempt to define romantic love through the casket test? I'll focus on this test only in terms of the romance plot for Portia and Bassanio, although I do think the casket choice as a test of love is significant for the entire play. The three caskets of gold, silver, and lead function as powerfully symbolic stage props for this play. As Nerissa explains, this test was a deathbed inspiration on the part of Portia's holy and virtuous father, who seeks to ensure that she finds a loving husband worthy of her by creating a test for love, not for money. Note, Portia has already inherited her father's wealth at his death. And by the way, another wise father, Prospero in The Tempest, stages a love test for the suitor for his daughter, and he explains why. Too light winning makes the prize light. Although Portia is understandably frustrated by her lack of freedom in choosing a mate, she does choose to honor her father's will. By the time Bassanio chooses, she has become convinced of her father's wisdom. Nerissa explains that whoever chooses the meaning of Portia's, that Portia's father has devised in this test, will choose Portia so that she will be rightly chosen only by one who she shall rightly love. So pray tell, what might that meaning be? The meaning of the test is to define right love and to enact that definition through the right choice. So what might loving rightly mean? The casket choice is no flimsy affair, as some critics have argued. Indeed, it is a centerpiece for the play's exploration of love and the difference between wise love and foolish desire. I suggest that Shakespeare uses the caskets not only as a test of appearance versus reality, but also as a test of wise love. Wise love is a complex concept, and this very problematic play revolves around tough choices either for or against wise love. The would-be lover has to discern and choose what is really good over what only seems good. As a test of wise love, the casket choice illustrates character and defines values. Usually in the world of comedy, love and folly are linked. But in this romantic comedy, Shakespeare boldly links love and wisdom. In the play, wisdom is spiritual understanding that prompts emulation of divine love, the ability to perceive the spirit behind the letter so that one can perceive truth and love wisely. Othello, for example, laments having learned this too late, when he, at the end of his tragedy, condemns himself for having loved not wisely, but too well, that is too much. When Bassanio chooses the right casket, Portia, so unlike the youthfully impetuous Romeo and Juliet, seeks a degree of moderation for her nearly overwhelming joy. O love, be moderate, allay thy ecstasy. I feel too much thy blessing, make it less, for fear I surfeit. Shakespeare's choice of the casket test, which he adapts from the medieval collection of stories known as the Gesta Romanorum, is his deliberate addition to the Italian story of the fleshbone. His artistic choice is telling. In the Italian fleshbone story, Shakespeare inherits a love test that he could have easily used and thereby saved himself a lot of extra work. What is that test? The test is essentially a bed trick. The Lady of Belmont says, whoever successfully beds her, weds her. If the suitor fails to perform in bed, he must forfeit to her all the wealth he brought with him to court her. What the suitor does not know is that before retiring, he's given a glass of drugged wine so that he sleeps through the night. This test depends on trickery, not character. Shakespeare does not choose this test's much more sexual orientation, but rather the more spiritual direction of the casket test found in the Gesta Romanorum. There, the motto on the lead casket is a giveaway clue. The chooser of lead reads that he shall find that God hath disposed for him. Shakespeare keeps implicitly this example of divine love as the model for human love, but he changes the motto from finding to giving and hazarding. Thus, he improves the fundamental contrast found in his source between the spiritual life of the leaden casket and the spiritual death of the gold and silver caskets. He also heightens the element of risk by making the suitors swear to injunctions before even attempting the test, namely that they will never reveal their choice, they must leave Belmont immediately, and they must sacrifice their right to marry. This last severe penalty emphasizes matters of the heart, making the consequences of failure dangerously personal for the denial of marriage and legitimate offspring. Just as Morocco arrives, six suitors leave Belmont, lacking even the courage to try the test. The test demands courage, but to be bold, as Morocco discovers, is not sufficient by itself. Shakespeare's most significant source change is his addition and development of the princes of Morocco and Aragon as important dramatic foils for Bassanio. And I think they are also analogs for Shylock, thereby further connecting the worlds of Venice and Belmont, but there's no time to address this now. For the basic meaning of Morocco's and Aragon's choices, Shakespeare is indebted to the allegory of the casket story found in his source. Morocco emphasizes more the golden medal and Aragon more the silver motto. In accordance with the allegory of golden choosers as given to worldly riches and the silver choosers as given to worldly wisdom. Morocco and Aragon fail this love test because they are worldly lovers who literally interpret the casket medals and mottos. And some self-revealing remarks appear in these suitors' soliloquies of rationalization. Morocco declares, a golden mind stoops not to shows of dross. I'll nor give nor hazard aught for lead. He's not supposed to be hazarding for lead, but for Portia, who is represented by the meaning of the leaden choice. Moreover, what Morocco himself terms his golden mind reveals his mental bias for worldly glitter. The motto on the gold casket reads, who chooseth me shall gain what many men desire. And he finds a death's head with a scroll explaining, gilded tombs do worms enfold. Had you been as wise as bold, your answer had not been enscrolled. Is love merely desire? The casket test carefully discriminates between these concepts. It suggests that desire is one element in love, perhaps the initial impulse, but it must be properly oriented so that it serves, not swamps love, reflecting Augustine's idea. Desire may be dangerous not because it involves hazard or risk, but because it can be primarily selfish. Love is primarily self-giving. In his book, Love in the Western World, Denis de Rougemont claims, happy love has no history in European literature. If so, I suggest this is perhaps because happy love is not the same idea as wise love. Wise love expects no primrose path of happiness without some unhappiness along the way. Wise love chooses to endure pain, sorrow, change, and hazard, yet bears it out even to the edge of doom. As Shakespeare says in Sonnet 116, devoted to the marriage of true minds. Aragon seems wiser than Morocco because he states he won't choose by externals like the foolish multitude does, but ironically, Aragon does choose by the showy promise of the silver motto. Who chooseth me shall get as much as he deserves. Aragon reveals his folly when he asserts, let none presume to wear an undeserved dignity, yet he unwittingly contradicts this when he foolishly declares, I will assume desert. In the silver casket he finds a fool's head with a scroll explaining his lack of judgment. Therefore, Aragon earns a shadows or illusions bliss because he is self-deceived. The speeches of both Morocco and Aragon are filled with self-reference and self-preoccupation, revealing their presumption and egotism that's so noticeably absent from Bassanio's later meditation. If, as we teachers of English maintain, the verb is the life of the sentence, then the verbs in the casket motto speak volumes. The gold and silver caskets bear the telltale verbs gain and get, but the lead caskets' verbs are doubly threatening, give and hazard. Thus, this love choice separates the takers from the givers. Both Morocco and Aragon think they truly desire and deserve to gain and get, but their choices are revealed as the folly of false faith. They choose as they do, believing they are right, but in fact, their choices are proven wrong. One reason I think Shakespeare cultivates some sympathy for those who choose wrongly, who love wrongly in this play, is because their choices are not primarily vicious, but misguided and unenlightened, as is often the case for us. Hence, the play emphasizes the educative crux announced by Portia in her first scene, the difficulty of knowing what is good to do and doing it. Both Morocco and Aragon ironically err exactly where they think they excel, and Portia explains this phenomenon most succinctly. Oh, these deliberate fools, when they do choose, they have the wisdom by their wit to lose. Their wit is worldly wisdom because they're worldly men. Literalists to abuse the letter by their blindness to its spirit. Their wrong-headed choices of love are appropriately awarded a death's head and a fool's head. However, Bassanio's right choice will be rewarded by a picture of Portia's head, the contents of the lead casket, because he chose her through understanding the meaning of that choice. As Portia earlier proclaimed to him, if you do love me, you will find me out. The opening line of Bassanio's soliloquy informs the audience that he will not make the same mistakes as Morocco and Aragon. So may the outward shows be least themselves, the world is still deceived with ornament. And his entire speech is a philosophical elaboration of the idea of non-correspondence, that things may not be what they seem, that seeming truth may entrap the wisest. Moreover, we know that in seeking Portia, Bassanio has not been a victim of show, since his initial praise of Portia celebrates her wondrous virtues more than her beauty, and extols her as nothing undervalued to Cato's daughter, Brutus's Portia. This Portia of classical antiquity was celebrated for both her wisdom and courage. Although he is attracted to Portia's wealth in order to repay his debts to his best friend Antonio, Lord Bassanio, as a nobleman, would be expected to marry according to his rank, and therefore Elizabethans would not be inclined to see him as a gold digger. As the Book of Job reminds us, wisdom cannot be purchased for gold or silver. Bassanio proves himself capable of the true lover's judgment by the mind's eye, not just the flesh's eye. It's not that he does not use his eyes, but rather that he uses them rightly. His viewing of the lead casket's paleness and threatening motto move him because he wisely sees the meaning of right love that Portia's father intended, the meaning that Nerissa explained was the interpretive key to the test. The motto on the lead chest reads, who chooseth me must give and hazard all he hath. Who would choose that? The true lover has to be selfless, to die to his selfish nature so that he can be willing to give and hazard all for the beloved. Gain, however, may be paradoxically the reward of giving and hazarding. As a consequence of Bassanio's right choice, he wins Portia. But the mystery underlying the test is that only in giving and risking freely for another, not motivated primarily by the expectation of personal gain, does one find true rewards. Although Bassanio wins, he generously defers to Portia's choice, empowering her when he says it must be her choice of him that confirms this event. Shakespeare's casket test represents a test of wise love by a choice that reveals one's internal worthiness, not one's external merits, revealing how one perceives reality. Insofar as we can avoid tragedy, Shakespeare's plays seem to suggest that to love well, we must attempt to love wisely in giving and forgiving. If God is love, as John asserts, and if we are created in the image of God, as Genesis states, I think we prove most godlike, not in our love of power, but in our power of love. How we choose to use our God-given gift for creativity determines whether we love or lust. Today, virtual reality is all the rage. Back then, virtue reality was supposed to be all the rage. Though they fell short, just as we do, the ideal was still there to measure the extent of the falling off, as the ghost laments regarding Gertrude's love. Oh, Hamlet, what a falling off was there. Whether we rise or fall, the heart of Shakespeare's drama for me is that he enables us, he moves us to see it feelingly, if I may adapt Gloucester's line to Lear in the Heath. Perhaps the transformative power of Shakespeare's art is like the transformative power of love. The recreation of his drama, like love, performs a recreation, as the Tempest says, a sea change into something rich and strange so that we see better, as Kent implores Lear to do before it's too late. We see better in order to be better. The play of our imagination or mind's eye mends, that is, changes, and amends, that is, improves, what the physical eye merely sees. Shakespeare's theatrical preoccupation with appearance and reality is not just aesthetic, but also ethical. The questions: what is appearance? What indeed is reality? Underlie the provocative power of his dramatic artistry. Shakespeare's plays do fulfill the Renaissance approval of Horace's dictum for art expressed in his Ars Poetica, namely that the poet should profit and delight by mixing the sweet and the useful. Shakespeare also exemplifies Sir Philip Sidney's ideal in his defense of poetry for the superior power of the poet as the best teacher, because the poet both delights and instructs, and thereby can literally move humans to well-knowing and even well-doing. For me, Shakespeare's drama achieves Milton's ideal for human love. He refines our thoughts and enlarges our hearts by moving us to participate imaginatively in the lives of his characters. And that is a uniquely human and humanizing experience involving both pleasure and pain. Just as Shakespeare's characters, though fictions, assume flesh and blood reality in our imaginations, so also his plays have a vitality or life of their own. Indeed, the act of creation involves the transmission of the life of oneself to others, whether that involves creating a painting, a play, a poem, or a child. Ultimately, the act of creation on stage is a behavioral phenomenon. Dramatists and actors transmit their lives to other selves and to the audience, and the audience responds with its vitality and empathy. That act may be seen as one of mutual generosity and love. Perhaps one aspect of Shakespeare's greatness in his creation of recreation is how well he captures this collaborative generosity. The felt endings of his plays enact in us what has just been enacted on stage. Consider the epilogue to The Tempest that is far more than just a clever appeal for applause. Having just enacted forgiveness of his enemies, Prospero now invites us to participate in that central action of the play. and my ending is despair unless I be relieved by prayer, which pierces so that it assaults mercy itself and frees all faults. As you from crimes would pardoned be, let your indulgence set me free. Are we not moved to see it feelingly? Although the Renaissance witnessed the flowering of English drama, only Shakespeare, of all the many talented playwrights, is continually performed throughout the world and in languages as different as Swahili, Russian, and Japanese. Many have written on why this is so. One reason I offer is love. No other dramatist at this point in time had co-workers who were also such devoted friends that they wanted to publish the works posthumously. If John Hemmings and Henry Condell had not given us the first folio in 1623, 18, or almost half of Shakespeare's plays, would have been lost to us. I think Shakespeare's friend and rival, Ben Jonson, gave Shakespeare the highest praise of all. It was he who declared in his dedicatory poem in the first folio that Shakespeare was not of an age, but for all time. And even though the meticulously learned Jonson criticized Shakespeare the poet for not blotting more of his inferior lines, he described Shakespeare the man in terms that explain in part why he might have been so loved. He was indeed honest and of an open and free nature, had an excellent fancy, brave notions, and gentle expressions. But Jonson said even more. And it is worth keeping in mind that this very gruff and tough man did not give praise or love lightly. Yet Jonson, I think, proved prophetic of our own heartfelt response when he said of Shakespeare, "I loved the man and do honor his memory on this side of adultery as much as any." Thank you. Much. We're going to do a question and answer now, but before we do, I'm going to say part of my lecture that I felt really got shortchanged was I wanted you to be able to appreciate the extraordinary eloquence that Shakespeare has in writing about the subject of love. And this really hit home for me. I'm going to do just a quick 6-minute DVD here. But when I was growing up, the West Side Story took all of us, we thought it was very similar to Britain. And if you look at the same moment when the lovers meet, and when the group sings West Side Story, which he based on Romeo and Juliet, and the first meeting of Romeo and Juliet in brackets of the lovers' production, you will hear in an instant how the culture, the languages, and Bernstein's world of music compared to the incredible cold-wind song that Shakespeare scripted for the first meeting of Romeo and Juliet. And he's been playing on it for many, many times. What? Okay. I'm in the way.
You're not thinking I'm someone else.
I know you are not.
Or that we've met before?
I know we have not.
I felt... I knew something never before was going to happen. Had to happen, but this is so much more.
My hands are cold. Yours too. So warm.
So beautiful.
Beautiful.
So much to believe. You're not making a joke.
I have not yet learned how to joke that way. I think now I never will.
Profane with my unworthiest hand this holy shrine. The gentle sin is this: my lips, two blushing pilgrims ready stand to smooth the rough touch with a gentle kiss.
Pilgrim, you do wrong your hand too much. Which mannerly devotion shows in this? For saints have hands that pilgrims' hands do touch, and palm to palm is holy palms kiss.
Have not saints lips and holy palms too?
Aye, pilgrim, lips that they must use in prayer.
Oh, then. Dear saint, let lips do what hands do. They pray. Grant thou, lest faith turn to despair.
Saints do not move. They'll grant for prayer's sake.
Then move not. While my prayer's effect I take, thus, from my lips, by thine, my sin is purged.
Then have my lips the sin that they have took?
Sin from my lips, oh, trespass sweetly urged. Give me my sin again. A rose will bloom.
And I'm happy to take any questions or comments. Okay, right. And may have to repeat the question so that, you know, everybody can hear it. Any questions or comments people want to add their own insights? Are they dying of heat? Yeah.
My first Shakespeare professor. comedy is everything that happens up until marriage, and tragedy is there's an old observation that there are no happy marriages in Shakespeare. Now, that some people would argue maybe the Macbeths have a happy marriage, but
until
that doesn't go very well for everybody else. So I just wonder how your comments about love and marriage might relate to what happens after. Everything kind of leads up to marriage. What about what happens after?
Well, yeah, that's a very good point. And I heard Ian McClellan give his one-man show on that. Of course, he had his own axe to grind on it, but it was always arguing that there are no happy marriages. I think Portia and Bassanio will have a happy marriage. They end with, of course, the ring. The episode of the rings is a mock trial in Belmont that plays out what has just proceeded before. But you can think of also Portia and Brutus. Now, of course, you bring that up and you say, yeah, well, she died swallowing hot coals. But they had a really, but that's because he's off fighting a battle and he's going to, you know, his life is over. But she proves her, I'm trying to think of it in terms of the plays themselves, she proves her ability to be constant and to take the heavy secret that he's carrying, you know, that he's going to join an insurrection, by putting a huge gash in her thigh to prove that she can be constant. They have a really solid marriage. He has withheld that information from her at that point. One thing I noticed when I was working on The Merchant of Venice, something that Shakespeare does that's really quite remarkable is he has Portia emulate friendship, which at this time was usually a virtue held primarily for men, you know, and she's praised by Lorenzo as having godlike amity, and she carries that all the way through. We don't have any, well, I think Ferdinand and Miranda, but we're only at the betrothal stage, will come through. How about you wrote on comedies of forgiveness? Who do you think? Because comedies have to have, by nature as a genre, they open in trouble and then happily. I'll give you one that nobody would think of, I think. Cordelia and the King of France. He takes her without a dowry. And Burgundy, oh, watery Burgundy, gotta have the dowry. But he does come back with her to fight to save her father, who had dissed them both, King Lear. But then he is called back to France, so then Cordelia leads the troops. So there's one, but they're not, you know, played out. It's much more fun to have, well, Kate and Petruchio, I get hung by some people for saying that, but I do think they reach, respect for one another by the end, though there's a lot of ways you can play the endings. Oh, good, yes. I do think that is a very well-seasoned marriage because of how beautifully they tease each other and the rapport. Right, that's a good one. That's a good one, too. But I don't agree with Ian McKellen on that score. Yes, way in the back. There's a... I'm sorry, I couldn't hear. Oh, the Capulets, yes. Thank you for bringing them up. Because what Zeffirelli will do with them, of course, Zeffirelli's writing or doing his stage production at the end of the 60s, which was considered the decade of the generation gap. So one of the things he brings into his film is having the Capulets look like they really don't like each other, and oh, that's a marriage, he was married too young, and so forth to him. But not so. When you get to the fourth act, when Capulet says that he's going to stay up all night in order, because he's promised Juliet to Paris, and he's going to make sure that he'll go into the pantry and get everything ready for the wedding the next day. They're teasing back and forth very lovingly and playfully. She calls him an old mouse hunt and so forth. So I don't see what, you know, I can see why Zeffirelli brought it in, because he made it made it very contemporary for the audience viewing the film. I haven't thought about this much. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
In your research, it seems as if you, among other things, mm-hmm. Which draws closer to God, and look for it, found it in this Shakespearean character. In your opinion, what is the character or watching or reading the play would enable us to transform to that characters that transform to ones that are aiming to love rightly.
Ooh, excellent question. Okay. For me, Desdemona comes to mind. First of all, let me preface this by saying Shakespeare's unusually good to his female characters. In fact, I just attended a talk where Barbara Mowat was speaking, and we were both were talking about this and agreeing on this point. Not all of them, but his women, particularly in the genre of comedies, women dominate, and they are almost paragons to which, not that they don't have faults, but they're smaller. They're paragons of virtue to whom the men aspire. But Desdemona blows me away. Cordelia also. But Desdemona in particular, why? Because she forgives knowingly, and I'd say her counterpart would be Prospero. But when she comes back to life, she now knows that her husband has been somehow deceived. She doesn't know all the details. But then she lies. And normally the tradition is that you, on your deathbed, tell the truth. And she says, but the situation in the room has changed. When she is strangled or smothered by Othello, she thinks he's the only one in the room. Then the words, Amelia says, my lord, and she comes in. And when finally Amelia makes her presence known to Desdemona and says, my lady, who has done this? Then she says, nobody, I myself. Well, what has Desdemona risked? She has risked going down as a suicide. At this time, suicides are usually buried at the crossroads with a stake through their heart. She's willing to risk her earthly reputation. And now she does tell a lie, and I find Shakespeare much better about this than, say, an author like Hawthorne. Hawthorne has Hester say in The Scarlet Letter, now I see a lie as never good when she confesses to Arthur Dimmesdale in the forest. Shakespeare allows for deceptions when there are greater goods. Maybe partially because of he's working in drama in disguise as part of part of what he has to work with. But Desdemona risks losing her earthly reputation. There isn't a man in that play that would do it. Even at the end, Othello wants to, you know, set it down. It's amazing when she does that, then we also have to give Othello some credit there because he does tell the truth. I mean, a lot of people when O.J. Simpson and the Nicole thing all blew up, people were saying, oh, this is the Santa Monica, Othello, and so forth. Othello, unlike O.J., whatever you think of that, Othello tells the truth, and if he had never told the truth, the lie may never, Iago's tale may never have come undone, because what Othello says is, she's like a liar gone to hell. When Amelia says, I must report what she said. She said she killed herself. And then Othello says, 'twas I that killed her. Then Amelia turns, and then slowly but surely, Amelia is able to begin to put, my husband, you say, husband told you? And then it starts to come full circle. But Desdemona's extraordinary. She says that unkindness may defeat her life, but never change her love. And I think she, a lot of people, I think some, I started working on her as an example of the ideal spiritual warrior that Erasmus writes about in his Enchiridion, which is a handbook for the Christian soldier or the Christian knight. And by the way, that's a textbook that would have been used in Shakespeare's grammar school. T.S. Baldwin and his, Shakespeare's Small Latin and Less Greek has trotted that piece of information out for us. But she's so much stronger than people have given her credit for. I think people are going to melt. I mean, you're just whoo-hoo. By the way, you are a great audience. Thank you so much for sitting through the heat. For sitting through the heat.
Joan, I can't thank you enough. This has been one of the most delightful evenings in my 7 years at Scranton. To welcome you here, I was transported back to being a 19-year-old sophomore at Georgetown, listening to you tonight. You talked about the tradition of imitatio, so important in the Renaissance. I've been trying to imitate the pure gold of your teaching and scholarship since I graduated from college. I think J.J. Quinn would be thrilled tonight to hear you talk about rightly ordered love, passion directed toward God, a concept originating in Augustine, but dear to Ignatius Loyola and at the heart of the spiritual exercises, which shaped J.J. Quinn's imagination and view of the world. You noted that wise love, according to Augustine, is selfless. I want to tell everyone here about your selfless love for generations of students through whose ministrations they have become wise. The transformative power of your teaching, like great art, both delights and instructs. And I was so very grateful to share my experience of my very best teacher with this university that I love. So thank you, Joan.